And we are back. You are chatting with John P. Today, we are going to be talking about everything that I think you need to know about Tudor watches. In recent times, Tudor has gone through a very interesting and certainly exciting transformation, but I want to talk about where Tudor originated, where they come from, you know, their connection to Rolex, and some other, you know, maybe little nuances and also intricacies about the brand that I think are pretty interesting. But first, I'd like to thank you for liking and subscribing. Please do hit the like and subscribe. It keeps me making these videos for you. And also, check out DelrayWatch.com, where you can see some Tudor watches pre-owned, of course, or you could sell us your Tudor watches pre-owned, of course, as well. And Instagram, TheRealJohnP, where I don't know if I have any pictures of Tudor watches, but I probably will soon. Instagram, TheRealJohnP. Starting off, Tudor watches. Okay, in recent times, they've had the Black Bay, they've had, you know, some flop releases where people wanted the Submariner, they've got chronographs, they've got everything that you could possibly want from a brand at an attractive price point for the quality that they do offer. But let's talk about where Tudor watches came from. So in 1905, Hans Wilsdorf began producing watches. He began producing watches before the Rolex name. In 1908, basically, he's the founder of Rolex, by the way, and Tudor for that matter. But in 1908, he began using the Rolex name in Switzerland, okay? So he started off in England, but then he moved to Switzerland, and of course, that is where Rolex began producing watches and watches up until where you see Rolex today. Now, oh, and in 1920, he moved to Geneva, for what it's worth. Excuse me. So in 1926, now this is where our story really begins for Tudor. 1926 is where Tudor pretty much officially began. He created the Tudor name because he wanted to pay homage to the Tudor dynasty and the Tudor history in England. Basically, they used the rose on the dial, and the rose was a very popular symbol for the Tudor dynasty, and the Tudor monarchs ruled the Kingdom of England and the territory that was owned by England for the time, including Wales, and they were of Welsh ancestry, and they also had some lordship of Ireland, but I'll admit I'm not really into the whole kings and queens things. I think personally, I think in 2019, it's pretty irrelevant to talk about monarchs and things like that, but it's an interesting point in world history. So, you know, moving forward from that, basically, Hans Wilsdorf wanted to give it this little interesting historical spin on the brand and still deliver a pretty good quality watch. So they produced some watches up until about 1940. But in 1940, they began to use the Rolex Oyster case. Now, the Rolex Oyster case, or a version of it, is what we see today in Rolex watches. Now, the Oyster case was very much alive in that time, and it was known and popularized and renowned for its ability to, they called it waterproof, but it wasn't technically waterproof. It was more water resistant, but you could submerge the watch in water and it was resistant to dust and other things. And that was really something very novel for the time because people were moving around. They needed a watch that was rugged, durable, and, you know, for very delicate watches at the time, to be able to keep your watch very safe was something you needed to do, especially as a professional. So Rolex watches were only using that Oyster case until 1940. Then Hans was like, hey guys, let's dump these things into Tudor. Now, so they started mixing in the Oyster case. Now, what was interesting about Tudor for that time, up until the 1960s, and even going forward, was Hans Wilsdorf really wanted to create a brand that was a little more affordable than the Rolex brand. They could still share some parts, some case construction. I believe that he put his friend in charge of Tudor for a while so that he could kind of run it and do things in a certain way because he was very busy developing the Rolex brand in the very early formative stage of that watch manufacturer. So some things were shared, right? Like the crown for a long time had the Rolex logo on it, the coronet. Certain parts like the bracelets were used as well. The case back said Rolex design. Now the one thing that the watches did not have was the movement. Now they pretty much just took off the shelves at a movements ETA, depending on how you pronounce that. They took the at a movements, very, you know, primitive but solid, proven movements. And they put them in the cases. So it was kind of where they managed to cut down costs a little bit. Also, the advertising wasn't as as much as the Rolex brand was advertising. They had a very interesting campaign strategy in about the 1940s for Tudor, and they were somehow advertising to coal miners as being an extremely rugged and durable watch that could survive coal mine, and they had some kind of trial experiment where they put some of these watches on some coal miners, and they had them mine with these things for hundreds and hundreds of hours, and they kept, you know, perfect, or what they considered to be perfect for the time, and they had a whole advertising campaign around that, and I think that's very interesting today. In fact, I would love to see Tudor bring back that whole thing and put like a Black Bay on coal miners and have them just beat them to shreds, knocking them on things and riding, you know, locomotives through the mines or however mining is done today. I would love to see that. It'd be very interesting and certainly bringing part of their heritage. But so, you know, going in that Tudor path, in about 1960, they changed over to the Shield, which is the popular Tudor Shield that we see today. I guess they probably just wanted to move away from that kind of like monarch and very like English or British aristocracy thing that they had going on and try to make it a more international and universally fitting brand, and they can kind of mold the watch into the market that they needed to. And so you saw a lot of Tudors popping up in emerging markets, right? Places in South America, places in, you know, parts of Asia. You know, Tudor became very popular in these other markets, and this time, comparatively, compared to what Rolex was or Rolex charges today, Rolex watches were, they were just much cheaper, right? They were more tool watches. They weren't luxury. People were not spending what they do on watches today, adjusted for inflation back then. So they were still tool watches, and emerging markets just needed a more price-conscious watch, at least if they wanted to sell a lot of them. And so that's what they did. And so you see certain watches that'll pop up on the internet, and they'll be coming from these locations because, you know, you go to South America, you go to parts of Asia, there's Tudors floating everywhere. And it's also interesting because parts of Europe were using Tudor watches, especially the Tudor Submariner, which I'll mention in the notable models section of this video. They were using these in parts of the military. They were using these in, like, the French military was very, it's very popular watch for the French military of the time, I believe, in about the 1960s. Just because it was more affordable, it was a little more rugged, they could replace it more affordably, though it's kind of interesting to see if the military was handing out Tudors today, but it just shows kind of where the whole watch market came, and that Tudor and Rolex really led that way, and it all started with Hans Wilsdorf. So Tudor kind of moved along and did their thing, and they were always kind of a couple steps under Rolex, but you know, keeping up with the models, right? Rolex would have a Daytona, Tudor would have a Monte Carlo. Rolex would have a Day-Date, Tudor would have a Day-Day, and they'd always share certain similarities, but always a little less production quality, less marketing, and also the movements. Rolex had their own in-house, and Tudor used other movements and maybe modified them in terms of chronographs, but they were, you know, they were certainly there, and I think they still hold up to today. But in about 2004, Tudor just stopped selling in the United States. Between 2004 and 2013, Tudor was not available in parts of Europe, interestingly enough, because that's where they were founded, and they were also not available in other markets, but mostly the United States. They completely pulled out. Personally, now this is where I jump from fact to opinion, I think they pulled out in 2014 because they were trying to develop more of a luxury brand around the Rolex name. And the thing with Tudor is a lot of Rolex dealers sold Tudor. So I remember before 2004, in fact, it could have been 2004, maybe 2005, and there were some watches still left on the shelf. I went to a Rolex dealer, and I walked in, and they had a Tudor Submariner, right? They used the Submariner name for the longest time, Tudor Submariner. And they had this a 40, a 36, and an even smaller mini sub. But I think I saw probably for the time maybe a 40 millimeter or a 36. And I said to the dealer, like, wow, like this looks just like a Rolex. And for that time, you know, I was like 15, 16 years old, I think, depending when I saw this, maybe a little bit older, maybe 18. So I asked them, you know, this looks just like a Rolex. What's with this? And that was very common for the time. They responded. They're like, well, it's actually basically Rolex. It's owned by Rolex. That was, and you know, it's composed of, it's built with Rolex parts and the Rolex factory. And that was every watch salesman's speech for Tudor in the United States prior to 2004. And even sometimes today, you'd walk into a Rolex AD, you'd see the Tudor, it's less expensive. And if you didn't need to have the Rolex, you'd buy it because you could have the Submariner, which the Rolex is known for. You can have the Date Day, you can have anything that Rolex had, there was an equivalent to Tudor for the most part. So that was always the story, and I think it was probably hurting the brand, or at least Rolex probably thought so. But, you know, they pulled out, and those watches dried up, and they disappeared until 2013, where there was a huge press release. Oh, Tudor's coming back to the United States, they're having all these new models, and everyone was excited. Watch geeks in 2013 were exploding because there was something new and exciting from a brand that had, you know, created themselves or positioned themselves globally to be the luxury watch. Rolex had an affordable alternative, and that's where modern Tudor comes from. It was going to have the shield. There was going to be a limited edition with the rose. Everything that you read about on the internet but you couldn't get your hands on was going to be there, though the letdown was the Submariner name was not going to be used. No, Tudor came out with the Black Bay. Now, in the Black Bay lineup, there are many watches, and I'm going to talk about them. So let's jump right into the section now called the notable models. So we'll start with earlier models, and we'll mix in some more modern models, and we'll end up in the contemporary section. So first of all, the Tudor Submariner, right? You had the Rolex Submariner, the popular dive watch. Tudor had the Tudor Submariner, featured many of the same characteristics, especially earlier on, shared bracelet. The case construction was oyster, very similar case, if not the same. They had a few different sizes, so if you wanted a 36 and not the 40, which Rolex was known for, you could have a smaller Tudor Submariner. I've owned a few of those. We have a couple of those at DelrayWatch.com. They don't last very long, so at the time of this release, you might want to check if we have it, but we get them in because we do go to some of these emerging markets to source these guys. We source these for you in some of the emerging markets, so check those out as well. So you had the Tudor Submariner. People were loving those. Moving on, though, Tudor has a Monte Carlo chronograph. Now, they've got two versions. They've got the gray and orange, and they've got the kind of the bluish one as well. Picture here. But these, the originals, have really jumped in price. Depending on condition, provenance, box, and papers, we're talking $14,000 to $25,000 for a watch that was probably under $1,000 when this came out. It was probably $800 or thereabout. And so, you know, these more rare exotic chronographs have really kept up, you know, comparatively with what Rolex Daytona models have done, which is interesting because it shows that there is a lot of parallel and there's contingency between the Tudor and Rolex brand, though not as much so. So these Monte Carlos are very hot. I'd recommend them. There's also a modern version of these. That's the thing with Tudor in 2019 and going back, you know, since they hit the US market in 2013, they've kind of, you know, mixed in a lot of their heritage into modern day and really cashed in on that watch guy, watch collector, vintage watch trend that's going on. And they are so smart for this. And people love the watches. They're honestly a pretty affordable for what they are, the modern Monte Carlos. Now the Ranger. Now the Tudor Ranger is a, I don't want to say a unicorn, but it's kind of a rarer model for the originals because there's a lot of redials and dial swaps floating around out there. If you get an original Tudor Ranger, you know, you certainly have something on your hands. They're not that easy to find. They start at roughly 5,000 plus. You can get a modern Tudor Ranger, right? We're seeing a bit of a trend here. Something old and something that looks just like it in a modern equivalent. So smart of Tudor. So the Tudor Ranger, you know, it's a rugged, sporty kind of watch. It's kind of what Tudor has in response to the Rolex Explorer 1, like the 14270 or 1016, something like that. So it's a good alternative to the Rolex Explorer 1, and you can have these things sometimes at $1,500 US pre-owned. Not much more to say about that watch. I personally love the watch, but once again, the originals are very hard to find. Now the alarm. Now Tudor made an alarm watch, you know, the Tudor alarm watch, the Tudor Advisor rather, and these things are just awesome. This is the only alarm watch that Rolex has ever made. The originals were produced by Rolex. You know, they didn't have a Rolex movement, of course, but they were produced by Rolex. They have Rolex bracelets. They had the Rolex case back, the Rolex coronet on the crown, and they are, they're just awesome. They're a piece in they're a piece in watch history that just marks a time where, you know, Rolex did something more than what they do, and they did things that other people did, right? Like, Rolex did not invent the alarm watch, though they produced one. So that, it's just a gorgeous watch, and the original Tudor's advisors have completely dried up. I was going to buy one about 1 year, a year and a half ago. I passed, you know, it just wasn't on my list, but now it's on my list to get a prime example, because good examples of this just dried up. The Tudor craze has launched, and you can't find a good example original Tudor advisor or Tudor alarm watch. Now, you can get, once again, the modern equivalent, but it's much larger. I believe it's over 40 millimeters. It's a larger watch. It's a little shiny. It doesn't perform. People don't buy it. It's hard to sell. But it's a great watch, so if you love it, go for it. That's what I can tell you about the modern Tudor advisor, but if you can find the original, one of my personal favorites, and it's just a piece in Rolex history that I think will really start to see some value jump, some upswing in the future. Moving on to the date day and the date. So, you know, the Tudor has a model that's just like the Rolex Datejust, and they also have a model that's just like the Day-Date. You know, like the Rolex Presidential Day Date. So there's not a whole lot you can say about that. You know, depending on the period in history, they share a lot of the same case construction and components, of course, with the movement not being the same, but a lot of the same great look from the same manufacturer, more or less, at a much more attractive price point. These have also started to jump up. Get one while you can, honestly, because every time we take one in, we have to pay more and more as time goes on. Last 2 years, we've really seen these, I don't want to say double, but definitely have jumped 30% plus, depending on condition and dial. Now, moving on to a model that never existed until recent times, until 2013, rather, when Tudor jumped back into the U.S. market, they came out with the Black Bay. Now, the Black Bay, it's your dive watch, right? It's kind of Tudor's current Submariner. Tudor flopped at this recent Basel, never came out with the new Submariner. They kept the Black Bay name in line. They've got a black bezel, they've got a blue bezel, they've got a red bezel, they have a stainless bezel, they've got one with no bezel, they got a green bezel, and they have a Bucherer model with a blue bezel, and they keep coming out with more bezels, and they've got chronograph versions, and it's unbelievable what Tudor's doing with the Black Bays. Now, I'll say, in modern dive watches, this Tudor Black Bay, the entire line, it's a good watch. It really is. It's rugged. It holds that original Tudor idea of being a more affordable Rolex. Shares a lot of style and design cues with Rolex, but it doesn't have Rolex movement. The case construction, it looks a lot like Rolex, but it really is not there. So, compared to what Rolex and Tudor used to do, it's a much more different game. You know, Rolex has really positioned themselves as 110% luxury, because you're paying 10% over retail for that 100% luxury at the minimum. Or, you know, you can have yourself a good, still luxurious, because, you know, they're not entirely cheap, but, you know, much less they can be had at discounts from retail, especially compared to the Rolex alternative. So there's a lot of these out here. I don't forget, there's also a Pepsi version, which has really taken off. Tudor has a Pepsi version. They've got a Black Bay 58, which is 2 millimeters smaller. There's so many out there. Let's focus on what's going on with this Black Bay line. So the quality is there. I would easily wear one. You can, very good watches for taking on the pool, casual wear, daily wear. You should not feel too bad if you knock it up a bit, because while it is an amazing watch, it's very nice. I love the Black Bay line, though I don't own any currently. As Tudor releases more of these Black Bays, I'll be honest with you, we trade pre-owned watches at Delray Watch. We see just the prices and the resale prices on these going down a lot. So it's a good thing for those that want to get into an attractive, more affordably priced Swiss dive watch or sports watch. You can pick up some Black Bays at $1,500 pre-owned, like if you're talking about the one without the bezel that looks a lot like an Explorer one from Rolex. And some of these others, to give you an example, the Harrod Black Bay, produced for Harrods. It has a green bezel. It was only released to them. You had to buy it through Harrods. About a year ago, one of the hottest watches. You couldn't get it because of the Rolex Kermit and the Rolex hook, you know, the green bezel thing was in. It still is. But now the prices on these have gone down to you can get them pre-owned for $4,000 if you find one private party. You know, that is less than half of where they were a year ago, and you see it across the board. Not as drastic as that, but even for the blue bezel, a bronze version of the Bucherer Black Bay, produced for a jewelry chain over in Europe, those have also gone down. And so the thing we see, and once again, I have to say this every video, but it's a fair point. If you love these, do not let anything I'm saying about value turn you away from these. I love them. I love a great value. We deal in pre-owned. Before I did this, I was primarily purchasing pre-owned because I do believe that it's the best value. So you can't beat a great value on a watch we all know is quality. So these Black Bays, they're really going down in price. Now, even the Pepsi has gone down a little bit, the Tudor Black Bay Pepsi. We've seen, you know, probably about a $500 decrease since the height of when these were being sold 4 or 5 months ago. And we see it on some of the other models that are a little more common, right? The red bezel, these have really lost their appeal. It seems like the guys that were drawn to the red bezel have sold them on the forums or sold them on eBay or sold them to dealers, and now they're getting into the Pepsi. So the Black Bay 58, the smaller Black Bay with, you know, with that artificial rivet bracelet looking a little more vintage, have really appealed to a lot of people that wanted a smaller Black Bay. And something like the Pepsi has also really appealed to pretty much all the Tudor guys. There's a group of guys, and they love the whole Black Bay line. And so, you know, very similar to the guys that, you know, I once was, the guys on the forums that flip and like trying out new watches. We work with a lot of you, and we definitely appreciate working with you. Love it every day. It seems like there's a lot of trying different things. There's even people that'll swap the bezels on them and make some modifications. So there's a bit of a group or a subcategory of watch collectors I find incredibly fascinating, and they're really drawn to this entire Tudor Black Bay line, and they swap between models. And I think it's because of that we see these numbers really going down. And when we pair that with what Tudor is really doing, and they're, for lack of a better term, they're really pumping and dumping these models a lot, because you see them at gray market. You see them close out. You can go to famous closeouters online where you buy brand new watches without the warranty cards, and you see the Tudors there across the board, and that's a sign that likely Tudor is dumping these out the back door because they did produce a lot of them. And that's not necessarily a bad thing because they are great products. I just wanted to convey that to you and to bring that to your attention, because when we trade watches here at Delray Watch, we keep track of everything in a proprietary system that I've built, and we track the prices and we can kind of model where we think future prices to go. So full disclosure, and I think it's incredibly insightful for those of you out there, to just let you know that these are great values, and right now there could not be a better time than now to pick up a Tudor Black Bay or any of these others. I don't know that we actually have any in stock. We've got some of the original Tudor Submariners, but the Tudor Black Bays, they're just really attractive watches for the price. I can go on all day about them, and you know how when I've tried them on, they're very durable, rugged, and you know, they're just doing what Omega did a long time ago. You know, they're producing a lot of watches, building up a really big name for them, and they'll probably try to jump back up to where Rolex was, pull back production, you know, tighten up their models here, you know, stop producing some of the colors that they have for the bezels, stop producing so many models, see, you know, based on their data, which models perform the best, focus on that, hone in their sizes. They've got the smaller Black Bay 58. They're going to see how that performs, if it performs better compared to their others, or if they've determined that there's a bit of a niche there for smaller wristed like myself. You know, dive watch guys, maybe they'll build out on that, put a GMT movement in the smaller one. So that's where Tudor's going. I wanted to share that with you, and also this incredible history about the brand. And I'm very excited to see what they do in the future, because while Tudor has such a long history here, almost as long as Rolex, a big chunk of history is just kind of missing. And I don't know if it's just missing for me because I'm in the United States, or if it's just missing for everyone. But looking at the time of history, even when they weren't in the United States, they really didn't do the best job in the emerging markets. They sold watches, but you know, I just don't think that they did a lot of notable things in that period. But I'm looking forward to the future. They're doing some pretty cool things, and I think next year, the next Basel, they're going to be releasing something that's really going to be heavy hitting to make up for the past year. Anyway, guys, that is what Tudor Watch is all about, where they came from, and also a little bit about how I see the brand developing and taking off into the future. Hopefully that you find that, I hope you find this incredibly insightful, and also I hope that you leave in the comments below, what do you think about Tudor? Are you a Tudor Black Bay guy? Or perhaps, for certain reasons, you think maybe not. I'd love to hear in the comments below. Also, who do you think, I want to know this, who do you think competes directly with Tudor today? I think Tudor's carved out a little bit of the market and pushed it aside, and they're keeping it to themselves based on my experience here at Delray Watch, and I want to hear what you think about that. Also, check me out, Instagram, The Real John P. Thanks for watching, guys. I hope you enjoyed it. Have a great week or weekend. What day is today? They all blend together when we're this busy. Anyway, guys, thanks for watching. You have been chatting with John P. Ciao.